The Demiplane of Dread, where Ravenloft takes place, is an artificially constructed plane located within the deep ethereal, and as such, you might imagine that elemental creatures work somewhat differently there than they do on a normal material plane. Just like in other realms, elementals can be summoned to Ravenloft from their home in the elemental planes by a spellcaster. Just like when summoning an elemental normally, a spellcaster would need a source of the same material as the elemental is made out of to house the elemental spirit while it's outside its native plane. The difference between summoning an elemental in Ravenloft and doing it on a material plane comes when the spell runs out. Now normally, an elemental is sent back to its home in the inner planes when the spell runs out, and should the spell end early, then there are spells such as Banish that can send the creature back to where it came from. Elementals summoned to Ravenloft, however, follow all the same rules of traveling to and from Ravenloft as any visitor from another plane does. And as such, they have the same chance of escaping as any player character has, and are trapped until they can find a portal or such leading home. Now, as you might understand, being pulled from their home and forced into physical form, only to find themselves permanently banished to a foreign realm, puts elementals into a massively foul mood. And as such, elementals summoned by spells not only remain permanently, but also immediately turn hostile towards their summoner, just as if they had lost control of their summoning spell before its time was up. And in most cases, an elemental summoned to Ravenloft will also be more difficult to control, requiring additional checks to bend it to a spellcaster's will. Whether this is a result of interference from a plane itself, or just that the elemental senses that it has been trapped and as such resists its summoner's control, is unclear. A note here, however, as I mentioned the banishment spell earlier, if an elemental is successfully banished, instead of being teleported to their home plane, the creature will just be teleported to a random place within Ravenloft. So, that might at least temporarily save your party from a rampaging elemental, but more than likely, you are just pushing that problem off to someone else. Other than the normal elementals you can summon from the inner planes, you also have several types of unique elementals that only exist in Ravenloft. These dark elementals are made up the very essence of a plane itself, and so I would say they are quite evil creatures. Each of these elementals can be summoned just as a normal elemental with the help of spells, though it's rare that one of them is summoned on purpose. Just like normal elementals, they require a substantial amount of their native material to be summoned into, as they lack a physical form normally. When they aren't summoned forth, the essence of these elementals exists in the mists that surround the domains of Ravenloft, and once their tasks are complete, they return there. All Ravenloft elementals also share a unique power of sorts, in that they are immune to wards and spells that are meant to affect extraplanar creatures, such as protection from good or evil. The reason for this is that this is their native plane. They are literally a part of the world, so they can often pass through barriers meant to keep out other elementals. Now, you might be thinking that you would stick to summoning Ravenloft elementals, since they go away after their task is finished, and they are far harder to stop than their normal brethren. They do, however, come with one rather large drawback, and that is that any summoning of a Ravenloft elemental puts you into fairly close communion with the pure essence of the plane, and as such, there is a real risk that the spellcaster is corrupted by the experience. Classically, this is resolved by a power check being required each time you summon a Ravenloft elemental. Now, power checks are a mechanic to track your character's slow decay into evil that exists in Ravenloft. Check out my earlier Ravenloft videos for more on power checks. There is, however, also quite a sizable risk that you will summon a Ravenloft elemental regardless of your intentions when attempting any sort of elemental conjuring spell on the Demiplane. Because of interference from the plane, and from the interference of the individual domain lords of the many different lands that make up Ravenloft, who can close off their home to travelers, there is a 20% chance each time you summon an elemental that it will instead be a Ravenloft elemental. Should there not be sufficient material for that kind of elemental to be summoned, then the Dark Powers will provide for it, forming just enough material for it to take physical form out of the essence of the plane itself. If this happens, the creature will be free-willed and will immediately turn on its summoner. Not only that, a Ravenloft elemental summoned accidentally forms an intense bond with his creator, knowing at all times where they are, and will relentlessly pursue them until either it or its makers are dead. Only by destroying the elemental can the summoner be safe. This is by far the most common way for these creatures to come into existence. So, what are these dark elemental creatures then? Well, there are four of them. Each could be considered a perverted form of a true elemental, and in some ways I would say they remind me of the para-elementals. The four types of elementals are Blood, Grave, Mist, and Pyre. Although all Ravenloft elementals are very rare, by far the rarest is the Blood Elemental, which is the Ravenloft equivalent to a Water Elemental, and this comes from a difficulty of obtaining the materials needed to create them. As the name implies, Blood Elementals are usually summoned into large quantities of blood, but they can actually be summoned from the lung water of drowned humanoids as well. Now you might think that blood would be in no short supply in a horror setting, and you would be right, but even if you're Strahd von Sarvich or Vlad Dracov, you might have difficulty providing enough blood for one of these creatures. Remember that you need the equivalent to a 10-foot cube of the material in question to summon the elemental into. And unless my math is off, which, let's be honest, it probably is since I spent less than a minute looking it up, that means you would have to kill around 50 humans to create one of these. Regardless, it's a lot of blood, like Evil Dead amounts. Regardless of the material used to summon it, a blood elemental takes the form of a vaguely humanoid figure, completely made out of blood. Instead of arms, it possesses two tentacles that it can use to interact with its environment. When it moves, a blood elemental will leave trails of dried blood in its wake, and it smells heavily of iron, so it's perhaps not the stealthiest monster. The blood elemental has two main ways to attack its victims. First, it can strike with its tentacles, which not only do a sizable damage on their own, but also drain the blood out of the creatures it hits. That blood becomes a part of the elemental and heals it. The second way it attacks is by engulfing its victims and forcing itself down into their lungs, drowning them in blood. Now, the elemental does have a weakness, however. And it's a little bit unexpected. Despite being a type of water elemental, the blood elemental is actually weak to water. If they enter or cross open water, the elemental starts taking damage each turn as they slowly dissolve. Next we have the Grave Elemental, which is a variation of the Earth Elemental. They need to be summoned from a soil of a graveyard or other resting place for the dead, and as such are far easier to find materials for. Grave Elementals take the form of huge, vaguely humanoid creatures made out of grave dirt with bones and the remains of crushed coffins sticking out of their bodies. I always also imagine the larger Grave Elementals' backs being covered with moss and tombstones as if a large portion of the graveyard had just stood up to attack, but it's just my own take on them. Power-wise, the Grave Elemental is fairly similar to their more normal Earth cousin. They can glide through Earth, do siege damage toward buildings, and do slightly less damage towards people who are flying. They do also have the power to innately cast the Sink spell once an hour as an action, targeting only creatures who stand on Earth or stone. Visually, I find them to be one of the more interesting elementals found in Ravenloft, but ability-wise, they are pretty boring, preferring normally to just punch things. That brings us to the Mist Elemental. They are a form of Air Elemental, and although it's not mentioned in the lore, I've always imagined that they are the most common Ravenloft Elemental, considering how easy it is to find large patches of mist compared to the rarer materials needed for the other elementals. Now, Mist Elementals look very much like normal patches of mist or fog, and as such are effectively invisible in normal fog and mist. Mist Elementals attack by moving through their victims. When it does, it has two options. It can either inflict damage caused by its chilling presence, which can be deadly on its own, or it can use a far more insidious ability to infuse evil into its victims. A creature targeted by this secondary ability needs to roll a saving throw, or their alignment is instantly shifted to evil, and they are charmed by the elemental. This might not mean that they instantly turn on their friends, but they will refuse to act against the elemental. Breaking this effect is not exactly straightforward either, as not only do you need to cast a remove curse on the target, but the caster needs to possess the same alignment as the character originally had. The last of the Ravenloft elementals is the Fire Elemental variant, known as the Pyre Elemental. Just as its name implies, Pyre Elementals need to be summoned from a pyre or some other form of large fire connected to a burial rite. Pyre Elementals take the shape of a large, thin column of fire, with slender tendrils of flame emerging from it that it can use to whip and attack its victims, causing fire damage, as well as damaging or destroying armors, weapons, and equipment. Also, if you're to believe the artwork, some Pyre Elementals have pieces of charred bone whirling around inside of their form, to which I say, why not? I mean, it might look cool, and it helps distinguish them from other Fire Elementals, but it's just one of those visual things, it's up to the DM, really. Well, that brings our little look at the unique elementals of Ravenloft to a close. Hopefully you've enjoyed it. If you did, why not leave a like? I will have a few more videos coming out about Ravenloft during October as a part of Ravenloft Month, so subscribe so you don't miss out on any of them. If you want to support the channel, then please share this video on social media, it really helps out a lot. Or you can also follow me on Twitter or Tumblr, or check out my DM's Guild product page. I'll put links to all of that in the description below. Until next time, Dungeon Delvers.